You see, what they've done is they've made us believe that racism is a social issue and racism is actually an economic issue. These people that get on TV will not tell you this. They will make you believe that racism is a social issue because they reduce racism to someone not liking someone because of the color of their skin. Racism is systemic. You always hear, racism is systemic. Racism is an institution. Racism is a system of control. Yes, because racism is economic. Economic exclusion is what caused us to have all these problems in America. We didn't have any resources. So when you don't have any resources, you are at the mercy of the people that are in control. I will say this again, racism is not a social issue. So if you want to fight racism, how do you fight racism? They've conditioned us to think that we can fight racism through social politics. Because the real purpose of civil rights was for us to have equity in this country. It had nothing to do with actual people not liking black people or us.
So we played Monopoly the other night and I didn't take any money. I wanted to take the place of the slaves that were emancipated in 1865, who did not get the 40 acres or the mule. And so I took nothing. Now, I survived for a few times around the board, but I couldn't buy nothing. And it was very soon I was out of the game. Now, you would say that that is unfair to have somebody sit down at a table and play Monopoly and not give them the $1,500 to start with. But that's what this country did with our people when they emancipated us.
These people on TV will not tell you this. They will not tell you that racism is an economic issue. Economic exclusion is what has hindered us in this country. But they reduce everything to a color and they make you believe that you can make someone like you. You can make someone accept you. You can make someone want to be around you. And that's just not true. No different than them, the media, making Donald Trump the face for racism like Donald Trump invented racism. America has been racist. America has practiced racism for over 500 years. The media has convinced everyone that Donald Trump is the face of racism. But what they've actually done is tried to convince you that you can fight racism without fighting it economically. So subconsciously you think that if Donald Trump is gone from office, racism will no longer be here and the country will automatically be better. But that's not how that works, because racism is an economic issue. And to practice racism, you must control the resources.
This is Jamal. Jamal is a boy who lives in a poor neighborhood. He has a friend named Kevin, who lives in a wealthy neighborhood. All of Jamal's neighbors are African American, and all of Kevin's neighbors are white. Because Jamal's school district is mostly funded by property taxes, his school is not very well funded. His classrooms are overcrowded, his teachers are underpaid, and he doesn't have access to high-quality tutors or extracurricular activities. Kevin's school district is also funded by property taxes, so his school is very well funded. His classrooms are never crowded, his teachers are very well paid, and he has access to high-quality tutors and lots of extracurricular activities. Kevin and Jamal live only a few streets away from each other. So how come they're growing up in such different worlds with such different opportunities for success? The answer has to do with America's history of systemic racism.
To keep us from fighting the real fight, which is an economic one, which is for equity and not necessarily equality, they just move the cheese. Let me ask you all a question. How do you fight racism? How do you fight racism? How do you fight it? There is no solution for racism other than equity. Black people only tolerate white people because we have no choice. White people control the resources, and so we are forced to deal with white people. These other communities deal with white people mostly on a business level. That's why you have Asian communities, you have Indian communities, you have the Spanish or Hispanic communities. You have all these communities that are pretty much their communities. They don't have to deal with white people other than for financial reasons. But us, it's different. We don't have any social leverage. We don't have any political leverage. And most importantly of all, we don't have any economic leverage. So we are forced to deal with white America in all three areas. We are forced to deal with white America in all three areas. We don't control anything. We don't own anything. Therefore, we are forced to deal with white America on all levels. There's no escape. We cannot escape white America. And even our communities, most of our communities lack resources. Most of the communities around the United States lack resources. You may have some in DC, you may have some in Atlanta, you know, some parts of the South, maybe some parts of the East Coast, but for the most part, the area that is black in a town is the area that lacks resources. Again, the fight against racism is not a social issue. Once you make it about your skin color, you are going to lose. Because what you are asking for is social acceptance. You're not asking for equity. And that was the ultimate problem of the civil rights movement. Because it started off being about equity. And then it ended up being about social acceptance. Just for all these years later, for us to not be socially accepted.
Let's look at what life was like for Kevin and Jamal's grandparents. Decades after the Civil War, many government agencies started to draw maps dividing cities into sections that were either desirable or undesirable for investment. This practice was called redlining, and it usually blocked off entire black neighborhoods from access to private and public investment. Banks and insurance companies used these maps for decades to deny black people loans and other services based purely on race. Historically speaking, owning a home and getting a college education is the easiest way for an American family to build wealth. But when Jamal's grandparents wanted to buy a house, the banks refused because they lived in a neighborhood that was redlined. So Jamal's grandparents were not able to buy a home, and because colleges could prevent them from attending through legal segregation, their options for higher education were really scarce. Kevin's grandparents, on the other hand, got a low-interest loan to buy their first house and got accepted into a handful of top universities, which traditionally only accepted white students. This opened up a wealth of opportunities that they were able to pass on to their kids and grandkids.
So you'll cure racism by curing the economic equity issue that we have in this country. We were excluded economically from the American economic system. That is the problem. It was economic exclusion. Think about it. They released all the slaves, but the slaves were the most skilled labor force because the slaves did everything. Inside the house, outside the house, in the field, in the barn, in the steel mill, we were the most skilled labor force. So think about what I'm telling you. If we're the most skilled labor force and we get released into society and it's even, we're going to take over. So how do you combat that? You combat it by releasing the people with no economic foundation. And you started to give our land back to us, but then said, you know what? We can't give them the land back because if we do, they will take over. Again, racism is an economic issue. How do you obtain leverage from the people? You take the resources. Again, it's an economic issue.
Even as late as the 1980s, an investigation into the Atlanta real estate market showed that banks were more willing to lend to low-income white families than to middle or upper-income African-American families. As a result, today, for every $100 of wealth held by a white family, black families have $5.04. A 2017 study confirms that redlining is still affecting home values in major cities like Chicago today. This explains how Kevin and Jamal inherited vastly different circumstances.
But I'll say it again. There is no such thing as black leadership. None of these so-called black leaders are saying we need our own political party. None of these black leaders are saying we need our own political party. Obama gave us the greatest example of what black leadership actually is. We just didn't want to see it. They've been lying to us this whole time, and they used us to do it. They put these people in front of us, And these people are just extensions of white oppression. If a black president couldn't do anything for black people, then all is lost in politics. We voted and got nothing. So don't tell me it's the vote. It's not the vote. It's the equity.
But being friendly and being a friend, I think, are two different things. I think there are many whites who act friendly toward Negroes. A fox acts friendly toward the lamb. And usually the fox is the one who ends up with the lamb chop on his plate. The wolf doesn't act friendly, and therefore the wolf has more difficulty in getting the lamb chopped in his plate.
I'd like to point out, though, that...
I say that because it is usually the, if you study the structure of the Negro community, economically, politically, civically, psychologically, and otherwise, it's controlled by the white liberal, who usually poses as the friend of the Negro, who actually differs from the white conservative in the same way that the fox differs from the wolf. Their appetite is the same. Their motives are the same. It's only their mannerisms and methods that differ.
None of these boycotts, protests, or rallies will do anything. This is something that's done that will be a trigger for COVID-19. Again, this is all a setup. None of these events taking place will bring about any change, because the only way to affect the system is to deprive the system of what it needs. This is why I'm talking about withholding the vote and withholding the money. Those two things are things that will cripple the system. So you fight racism by economically boycotting those in power. That's how you fight racism. You don't fight racism begging and pleading for someone to accept you. That is not how you fight racism. That is a personal issue.
I would agree that no doubt there have been a large number of whites who have posed as liberals and as friends of the Negro and who have time and again betrayed the Negro. On the other hand, I think one could point to a large number of whites who have struggled for civil rights, for equality, and have got little or nothing out of it, other than quite a few bruises.
Give me an example.
Well, the large number of white students who have gone into the South, for example, working for SNCC and other organizations.
Not working for SNCC or other organizations, but working for the white political machines who benefit by the voting efforts of Negroes.
Okay. I'll be more specific. I would cite Herbert Hill, for example, as a kind of person who has championed Negro job rights, for example, in New York City and elsewhere.
We have, I wish I had three hands, we have police brutality, we have unemployment, and we have COVID-19. What is the vote going to do to fix those things? Please tell me. What is the vote going to do to fix those things? The only solution they have for us, the only solution they have for you and I, is to vote Democratic. Do you understand how it's a setup? The vote only matters if you require something for the vote. The vote only matters if you demand something for the vote. If anyone can have your vote, anyone meaning Democrats, can have your vote, then your vote isn't worth anything because you aren't demanding anything for your vote.
The first time I met Herbert Hill personally was when they were picketing to stop the working on the Harlem Hospital in Harlem. Negroes for 10 years had to fight the city to get an annex built on the Harlem Hospital, because in Harlem we need a hospital more so than anything else. Our people are sick, plus we do a lot of cutting and shooting of each other, though we profess to be nonviolent. And Herbert Hill brought his forces out and stopped the working on that site. This is the first time I ever saw him. Then, when work was brought to a halt on a hospital in Harlem, the same Negroes tried to stop the work at the Downstate Medical Center in Brooklyn, which is predominantly white. They were out there for 3 months during the summer, couldn't stop anything. And I never saw Herbert Hill out there one time. Now, whenever it takes a stoppage of something that's going to affect the white man, you find the white liberal absent. But when it involves something that primarily will affect the best interests of black people and black people only than that white liberal is president.
Now, how do you fix unemployment? Think about it. How do you fix unemployment? They're going to tell you to vote Democratic. But how do you fix unemployment? More jobs would mean more employment. So they're going to convince you that voting for a Democrat is going to bring more jobs. That's not how it works. But these leaders, these vultures, these snakes, these rats, these liars, these charlatans, these leaders they put in front of us, namely, these leaders that look like you and I, only intend to keep us oppressed. They only intend to keep us oppressed. They only intend to keep us down. They only intend to keep the system functioning how it's functioning right now because they are cashing a check.
I'm suspicious of whites who join Negroes and always have to be in the lead, who always have to be the head, who always have to be at the top in Negro organizations. Those whites who really have the interest of blacks at heart, let them give some advice to some Negroes and stand on the sideline, but don't join the organization and then get at the head of it and pose as a friend of Negroes.
Well, I would defend his sincerity and his commitment. And more than that, I would say that just because a person is a Negro or a black American does not mean that he's going to struggle for Negro rights or for jobs for Negroes or anything else. I think that today you could point to a large number of Negro leaders who have consistently betrayed Negroes in a whole host of areas.
They aren't really Negro leaders. These are puppets that have been put in front of the Negro community by white liberals. These are parrots that have been put in front of the Negro community by white liberals. You can't name me a Negro leader who has been betrayed Negroes, who has not been endorsed, sanctioned, subsidized, and supported by the white liberals.
We just saw the economy buckle in 2 months. We just saw the economy buckle in 2 months. Imagine what would happen if we unplugged from this system. With us being a profit margin, imagine what would happen if we unplugged from the system. We have the power. But these leaders they put in front of us will not tell you this because they are getting paid. Those leaders, those black leaders, are an extension of white oppression. They are a part of the system. And their goal is to keep things the same way. I'm telling you right now, liberation is right here. Liberation is right here. We got the power right here in our hands right now. We just saw COVID buckle the economy in 2 months. Game over.
And if we take that big leap, I am convinced that the problems that we confront today can be solved, but it takes a big, bold action and $14 trillion in reparation for damages visit upon the heirs of slaves is an appropriate statement.
And the only thing holding us back is fear. The only thing holding us back is fear.
Where would the $14 trillion come from? I mean, lately, we've been thinking we can do $3 trillion here, $3 trillion there. This would be through some type of wealth transfer from the haves to people that have the money, the wealthy individuals. Where would that $14 trillion come from?
Well, let me just say, on the contrary, I put out this statement it's on my website, been on my website since 2019. Really? About the need for this reparation. So I'm not new to this challenge. But to the point you're making is that wealth transfer is exactly what's needed. Think about this. For 200 plus years or so of slavery, labor taken with no compensation is a wealth transfer.
We are afraid that if we do what we need to do, things will never be the same. We are actually afraid to not be oppressed. We are actually afraid to be liberated. And you know why? Do you know what's at the core of that fear? At the core of that fear is we won't have any more excuses.
The housing program that we at All in America believe in, that your house is your your home is your castle, and therefore the government has historically subsidized mortgage lending by allowing you to deduct it from your taxes. But think of this. African Americans with no accumulation of wealth cannot afford to meet the down payments of home ownership, and therefore they live in apartments and where there is no deductibility for the interest they pay on their lease, for the income they pay on their lease.
We have to be who God said we were. We have to be who God said we were, not who they said we were. We have to be who God said we were.
That's why today, African Americans are about 40% of home ownership. White Americans are 70%+ of home ownership. When you put all of these factors together, lack of access to education, lack of access to home ownership, the primary source of wealth for most middle-income Americans, and discrimination, you have had for the past 200 years, in effect, a wealth transfer from white Americans away from African Americans.
So if we are truly the chosen people, then the choice should already be made.
At the very same time that America refused to give the Negro any land, through an act of Congress, our government was giving away millions of acres of land in the West and the Midwest, which meant that it was willing to undergird its white peasants from Europe with an economic floor. But not only did they give the land, they built land-grant colleges with government money to teach them how to farm. Not only that, they provided county agents to further their expertise in farming. Not only that, they provided low interest rates in order that they could mechanize their farms. Not only that, today, many of these people are receiving millions of dollars in federal subsidies not to farm, and they are the very people telling the black man that he ought to lift himself by his own bootstraps. Now, this is what we are faced with, and this is the reality. Now, when we come to Washington in this campaign, we are coming to get our check.
Wait for it. Free Blacks, get money. Go.